before I start, I have a very special privilege because I'm the last speaker. So whatever I say, you can't do anything because we're all going to leave. But what I want to do is I want to thank two people who have been behind the scenes throughout this entire institute and have made it such an amazing experience for us. That's Ellen and Carlos.
IT support team, room schedulers, and everything else that anybody could possibly have done. So thank you guys very, very much.
Exception, so I'm going to set the stage, and in this case it's going to be almost literally setting the stage because I want to introduce a particular character. His name is Armchair Linguist, and he has been described rather accurately, if not too charitably, by Chuck Fillmore in this very memorable quote, which many of us know, where he says, Armchair Linguistics does not have a good name in some linguistic circles. A caricature of the armchair linguist is something like this. He sits in a deep chair with his eyes closed and his hands clasped. Once in a while, he opens his eyes, sits up abruptly, shouting, what a mean fact, and the quote goes on. So the reputation of armchair linguists is definitely a little bit tarnished. But I don't think it should be, because what armchair linguists do beyond this description is actually quite valuable. They consider and reject different linguistic analysis, different analytical options, and that's what science is all about. So if we go back to a meme, which was very popular a couple years ago, what they really do is something like this. So they basically balance different analytical options, and they try to pick the best one given their argumentation. But many of us now in the field perceive their work as something completely outdated and medieval, and so if we continue with the meme, what they really do is not exactly what we think they do. And if we have this medieval perception, then the obvious thing to do is to burn your armchairs and to charge your gadgets, because you now have big data, you have corpora, we have behavioral experiments, we have neuroimaging, so we're all now cognitive scientists, we're experimentalists. And because of these out-of-the-armchair people appear enormously glamorous, we usually think that they do something like this. But if we go back to this well-tried meme, what they often do is this. And if we now combine the less charitable portions of the meme, what you see is the battle of perceptions. So you basically have something like that. And each side views the other side with a lot of suspicion, which means that it's time to sit down and have a talk. And when I say sit down and have a talk, just like with setting the stage, I mean that pretty much literally. Because before we embark on doing various experiments, we should all do what Fillmore's armchair linguist does, and that is we should sit down and think what we can do. Armchair linguistics is quite cheap, but what I would like to suggest is that it actually offers a significant gain, because although it's cheap, it's only after you've thought very hard about the various issues that you can be ready to run an experiment. So the cheapness of armchair linguistics comes with a significant and very valuable contribution. And so when we sit down to think, the questions that we often try to think about is something like, what is it that I should think about when I prepare an experiment? What can go wrong if I charge ahead? And here's a question that I think we often fail to ask ourselves. I'm not casting aspersions, so I'm not implicating any member of the audience, talking only from my own experience, but this is a question that we often fail to ask. When is it that we're not ready to run an experiment? And this is one of the issues I would like to address today. And in my remaining time, I will try to talk about these four issues. So when is it that we're not ready to run an experiment? Then I'm going to talk about the best laid plans. Then I'm going to present the best case scenario for an experimental study and suggest some ingredients of a recipe for success. So my first question is when we're not ready to run an experiment. And today I'm going to give four examples and four answers to this question. I want to start with a disclaimer. All the examples I'm going to show are fictional, and any resemblance to experiments living or dead is purely coincidental. And the other disclaimer I want to make is that the list of the four answers is actually not exhaustive. So the first answer is, when are you not ready to run an experiment? When you don't have a hypothesis. So let me give you an example from a well-known double is construction that we all know and love. So it's known as reduplicative or double copula, is, extra is, thing is construction, and there are lots of examples on this slide. Which people produce all the time. The thing is people talk this way. I don't think the answer is to have thread B. The result is that when the car gets hot, what's nice is that it has a sort of otherworldly character. So this is very common. It's well attested in contemporary American English, in Australian English, and in New Zealand English. It seems to have first appeared in the second half of the 20th century. Then there was a striking increase in the use of focus expressions in the 60s and 70s. This is well documented and favored in a wonderful paper by Kurzan. And there doesn't seem to be any evidence of geographic or sociological factors that may characterize how it's distributed across speakers. So it looks like there is some work for dialectologists to do. There have been quite a few analyses of this construction. The two main ones in syntax are the analysis which associates this construction with the pseudocleft. So the idea is that you start with something like what the problem is that you're always late, then you delete what, and you end up with the construction you need. And the second analysis goes back to Dwight Bollinger, and the idea there is that the second is the focus marker. And that has been recently revived in some work by Liz Kopok and her colleagues. So this is the set of two analyses. So if you look at this, is construction, you say, well, nobody has studied experimentally, so I will. But before you do, the first question we want to answer is, what exactly is it that we want to find out? If we want to separate the two syntactic hypotheses, we need some kind of an experimental hypothesis about the environments in which the structure is or is not used. We also need a way to distinguish production and comprehension of thing is sentences. And so just looking at this is very interesting, but the bottom line is something is interesting, but that's not enough of a reason to study it experimentally unless you really know what you're doing. So that's my first example. My second example is what I'm going to call the Batman sentences. And the answer to the question I posed, when is it that you're not ready to run an experiment, is when you don't have a hypothesis that's informed by linguistic literature. So let's look at a very simple minimal pair. I told Batman a joke that he laughed at. I told Batman a joke that he was E.T. So we have two sentences with that clauses. They're shown here in brackets. And if you look at them just superficially, you may think, well, I have a minimal pair because I have two that clauses, but both involve co-indexation between Batman and he. But only sentence one has a filler-gap relationship. So presumably one should be more difficult than two. So let's compare them experimentally. Again, nobody has done that, let me do that. Well, before you think about this experiment, think that things are not that simple because the difference between one and two, as syntacticians know quite well, is not just in the number of dependences, it's the difference between an adjunct and a complement. So I'm just showing this. here with two subscripts. So I told Batman a joke that he loved that, an adjunct clause. I told Batman a joke that he was E.T., a compliment clause. And we can show their differences by using primary data quite extensively. So if we extrapose these constructions, then we will find that they're actually quite different. So if you look at the examples on the screen, where yesterday appears at the very end of my examples, they're both bad. But we know that movement under normal circumstances is incapable of bleeding condition C, whereas adjunction can do that. So we can easily predict that our adjunct clause should be able to have some kind of a binding between he and Batman, whereas our complement clause would not. And that's exactly what we find. So if you look at the examples here, I told him a joke yesterday that Batman laughed at. It's totally fine. Whereas I told him a joke yesterday that Batman was ET, continues to be bad. So we've unmasked this minimal pair by using extraposition differences. And this is something that started out as a bunch of armchair judgments, going back to Edwin Williams and David Lebeau, and then more recent work by Danny Fox and Nissenbaum. And this is something that a couple of people have actually confirmed using an online survey of Mechanical Turk. So here's your experiment using American English. So things are nice, and they look very good. So nobody has really compared the Batman sentences experimentally, and I would say that's good, because we don't want this experiment, because it will have a serious problem in its design, because the contrast that such an experiment would have investigated would be confounded by factors that we already know about. So if your experimental question is not confirmed by your theoretical knowledge, then maybe it's time to sit down again and think about whether you want to do that or not. So let's look at my question again. When are you not ready to run an experiment? And the third answer I would like to give is when you don't know enough about processing principles or experimental methodology. So let's look at my imaginary experiment number three, which I'm going to call There Is Something About Mary. So you have something like, how many people did Kim talk to about Mary? How many people did Kim talk about Mary to? So you have two PPs in different positions. And as a syntactician, we immediately say, I want to look at those experimentally because I want to study intervention effects in prepositional phrases. So a theoretical linguist would be interested in those because they would be keen on finding something about intervention under some extraction. But we also have to remember that whenever participants take an experiment, they actually process language. So processing considerations also need to be taken into account. And the simple processing consideration here is the active filler hypothesis. The idea being that when you have some kind of a filler of a particular category in a non-argument position, you try to assign it as early as possible. So that's the idea. So the active filler hypothesis would say that the parser would actively construct dependencies online without waiting to see them confirmed at the gap position. And the active filler hypothesis predicts that when we have something like how many people did Kim talk about, as soon as we encounter about, we will try to create a dependency between how many people and that preposition. And that would be preferred over other parses because of the active filler hypothesis. But then Mary will show up, and that will get in the way. And so you will try to look at these sentences from the syntactic standpoint. But because of the active filler effect, we probably wouldn't be able to learn too much about intervention in this comparison because we haven't taken into account some processing considerations. So again, nobody has looked at the Mary sentences experimentally. Let me do it, don't do it. Because you don't want to do it without understanding that it's not all about grammar. And there are certain other things that have to be taken into consideration. And then finally, my fourth answer, when are you not ready to run an experiment? When you don't have a hypothesis that really informs linguistic theory. So there is a lot of very strong experimental evidence which shows that noun-verb distinction is quite strong. And the experimental evidence suggests that nouns and verbs are assembled at different levels, that they're probably represented at different regions of the brain. And when I was preparing this talk, I was thinking, which references should I use? And I realized that there's so many that the best thing I can offer is this survey article by Villoca and several other people, where they go through a lot of really interesting neuroscientific and behavioral evidence showing that nouns and verbs are processed. So let's say we decide we want to look at Mandarin Chinese, because Mandarin Chinese, just like English, has significant homophony between nouns and verbs. In fact, according to some researchers, it's about 45% of nouns in Mandarin Chinese that have verbal counterparts. So someone can say, well, let's run a study showing that Mandarin speakers distinguish nouns and verbs. And I would say, no, let's not do that, because that would already tell us something that we know. We know that nouns and verbs are different. We know that linguistically, and we know it behaviorally. So it wouldn't really add very much to what we already know. And if you're so worried about nouns and verbs as separate categories, it may be better to spend time on languages where the noun-verb distinction is actually in question. And these are polysynthetic languages and some other types which aspire to polysynthesis. So languages for which noun-verb distinction has been disputed include Salish, Northwest Caucasian, and Austronesian. And if you look at these languages, what you find is that there are a couple of recurrent generalizations. The first one is that things which are lexically nouns, which are born nouns, appear bare in argument positions. But things which are derived nouns can have to be overtly marked. So that seems to happen all the time across various polysynthetic languages. And the other generalization, which we see at least in a subset of these languages, is that only lexical nouns can combine with person number possessive prefixes. And I'm going to show you evidence from Circassian introducing the second fact. So only nouns can combine with person number possessive prefixes. So on the left, you see the word for cup, which is a borrowing from Russian, chashkin. On the right, you see the nominalization, the broken one. Only the word for cup can be combined with first singular or any other possessive prefix. So you can say my cup, but you cannot say my broken one. So we have a very striking contrast. Something similar has been found in some Salish languages. And so the question is, what accounts for these generalizations? And that's an outstanding question. I hope that at the next institute there will be an answer, but for now I don't have one. And so I think that this is a time where we need to go back to that armchair, which hasn't been very popular lately, and consider different hypotheses that can explain what we see. So my kind of list of answers to the question, when you're not ready to run an experiment, includes cases when you don't have a hypothesis, when the hypothesis is not fully informed by linguistic literature, when the hypothesis is linguistically solid, but the experimental factors come into play, and when there is a hypothesis that doesn't really inform linguistic theory. And I put the dots here because I think there are many more situations where we need to think where we're not ready to run an experiment. So all in all, there are many cases when we're not ready to run an experiment, and the important thing is that if nobody has done something, that's not enough of a reason to do that. So if something looks interesting, that's again not enough of a reason to run an experiment. It's good to start with a question, with a hypothesis, potential implications, and minimal confounds. Even that doesn't always work. And that's where I'm going to talk about a little bit of my own experience, which I call even the best laid plans. And this is where we did something, we were all set to go, and then we got the experimental outcome, which we did not expect. So we essentially got the null result. So that's an illustration from my own experience that even the best laid plans go awry. So we know from a lot of literature that there is a strong preference for subject relatives over object relatives. So there are two famous sentences here about the poor senator and the poor reporter. So, and the generalization is that the reporter who attacked the senator is preferred over the reporter who the senator attacked. So that has been shown experimentally on a bunch of languages, English, German, Dutch, Japanese, Korean, Russian, Turkish, and quite a few people who actually did this wonderful work are here in the audience. So it's kind of humbling to see how we all sort of converge on this. But notice that a lot of these languages, most of these languages, are accusative languages. So they have the accusative alike. So nobody has looked at the same question in ergative languages, where we have this kind of alignment, where the sole argument of an intransitive and the theme-like argument of a transitive are the absolutive, and the agent of a transitive, a subject or agent of the transitive clause is in the ergative. And so if we now move on to a non-imaginary experiment, we can compare ergative and absolutive gaps, and we can have two hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that the ergative gap should be easier than the absolutive gap. And that's because the ergative is subject, and we already know that subject relatives are easier. So the prediction is that ergative gap relatives should be easier to process than the absolutive object gap relative. On the other hand, we know that it's typical to treat those relative clauses whose head is morphologically marked in the base position as more difficult to process. And typically, not always, but typically, the ergative is more marked than the absolutive, so the ergative gap relatives may be expected to be harder to process than the absolutive object gap relatives. This is the analysis that was proposed for BASC by Carreras and several other researchers. So we have two hypotheses. Either the ergative will be easier or the absolutive object will be easier. And viewing those two hypotheses, we did some experiments on two languages, Avar, which is basically Japanese in disguise. It's like ergative version of Japanese with pre-nominal relative clauses. And then with an experiment in the Polynesian language, Niuean, which has post-nominal relative clauses. A lot of people who speak these languages don't really read, so the experiments were done using picture matching. And so we did something like this, let's see.
The dog that the cat is licking. Where is the dog that the cat is licking?
Okay. Which one is the right animal? Okay. Looks like you're all good speakers of English. So this is the essence of the experiment. And in this non-imaginary experiment, we found that the ergative and absolutive gaps were exactly alike. So neither of the hypotheses panned out. So if you look at the results for Avar type picture matching, the response time on correct choice was completely the same for ergative gaps and for absolutive gaps. If you look at the Nguyen picture matching results, again, response time on correct choices, again, not distinguishable, they're essentially the same. Same goes for accuracy. So basically, hypothesis A, the ergative should be easier than the absolute, was not supported. Hypothesis B, absolute should be easier than the ergative, wasn't supported either. So we have a null result. And when we got that null result, we all said, well, now we need to understand it, and we tried to make some sense of it. So the idea is that subject preference is somehow composed of case preference, where the independent case might be easier than the dependent case, and grammatical function preference, where the subject prompts the object. And so these two preferences work together. They work in sync in accusative languages. But they cancel each other out in ergative languages, where the absolutive is not the dependent case and the ergative is the subject. And because these two guys cancel each other out, the hypothesis didn't work out. So we did learn something post hoc, but notice that the initial hypothesis was not confirmed, and of course, as everyone starts in an experiment, I was thinking, well, I've taken care of everything. I've controlled for the length of every word. I've normed with 36 of our speakers, with 18 Nguyen speakers, and look what I've done. So it's good to start with a question, with a hypothesis, with potential implications and minimal confounds, but even that doesn't always work, and if we're lucky, we'll learn something post hoc. So let's now think if we can have at least some happy story. So can we have a happy experimental story? And I would like to present one best case scenario, which doesn't mean that it's the only one. So I sort of started thinking about that, thinking about the question, what's worth trying? And as always, you go back to Karl Popper, who says, insofar as scientific statement speaks about reality, it must be falsifiable. And insofar as it's not falsifiable, it does not speak about reality. So I think the key words here are scientific, reality, and falsifiable. So we want the linguistically relevant distinction. It would be good to have a clear hypothesis and arguments that can falsify this hypothesis. And the reality, in my opinion, consists of good manipulation with no processing compound. So before I give you an example, one disclaimer, it's a personal preference. And I don't want to leave the audience with the idea that this is the only good experiment I've ever seen. I just wanted to pick one. I have about 15 minutes left, so I have to make my choices. So the one I want to present very briefly is the work by Toscano, Murray, Denhardt, and Stephen Locke on continuous perception and graded categorization. So what they did, they looked at the linguistically relevant distinction between phonetic and phonological representations. And the central question they asked was whether or not perceptual encoding can capture acoustic detail in a one-to-one fashion, or if it's affected by phonological categories. And the implications of this study seem quite significant, because they basically tell us whether phonetic representations matter only as input to phonological representations, or they may be accessed continually. So their first hypothesis is that perceptual information is only relevant as input to categorization. Once you form a category, then within category distinctions are overlooked. And the second hypothesis is that perceptual information is accessed all the time, even after categories have been established. And that means that within category distinctions are continuously tracked. So they used event-related potential methodology in which listeners categorized spoken words which varied along the continuous POT in an auditory task. So the idea was distinguish beach and peach, or dart and tart. And they used two main measures. I'm going to try to talk about just very few of those. So they used the measure called N1, which happens about 75 to 125 milliseconds after the stimulus, and responds to a wide variety of stimulus types. And it's typically taken as a measure of perceptual level processing. So in particular, it encodes differences in acoustic information in a very broad sense of the word. The second measure they looked at was the so-called P3 component, which reflects categorization in a very large number of domains, not only speech, but other domains as well, and phonological categorization is one of them. So we're going to look at N1 and P3, and essentially this is what they did. So they have something like target stimuli when beach is target, so you get quite a bit of VOT distribution, and these are target stimuli when dart is target. So in this figure, you see that a hypothetical participant will have a category boundary between 15 to 20 milliseconds VOT for beach, peach. And similarly, they will have a boundary between 20 and 25 milliseconds for the dart and tart continuum, which you see at the bottom end. And so if stimuli ranged within that continuum, they were considered on target. So this is what their N1 looks like. So this is N1 amplitude. And basically, I don't expect everyone to read this chart, but what's important here is that N1 amplitude decreased as the VOT was increasing, and this effect was observed for both relevant and irrelevant conditions. So what mattered was whether or not the VOT was on target, whether or not people were listening to beach or dart. So they were still looking at the differences in VOT. So this is what I just said. That means that non-phonological representations of speech are maintained until very late, up to 100 milliseconds of stages of perceptual processing. So this is one of their charts. The people are listening to beach and peach, so they expect to hear beach and peach. Here's the target is beach. Here the target is dart. But what you see is that no matter what the target is, they're still paying attention to perceptual categorization, and essentially, even when the task is not relevant to this distinction, people are still noticing it. So this is merging the two figures. So what this all means is that the graded acoustic detail is preserved at the post-perceptual level and maintained at post-phonological stages, which is also consistent with some other neuroimaging and behavioral work, which shows that graded phonetic characterization actually applies. So if we go back to their two hypotheses, the first one is perceptual information is only relevant as input to categorization. Once you form your category, you're done. The second hypothesis is that even when you form your category, you still continue accessing perceptual information, and the results clearly argue in favor of the second hypothesis. So maybe I like this because I'm not a phonologist, but I thought it was a very clear hypothesis. There was an important distinction involved there. It was a very simple manipulation. We all know about beaches and peaches and tarts and darts. And if you look at the paper, several people knew different things. So the question is, can we learn from them? And that takes me to my last point, the recipe for success. So I think that it's very important when we do all this work, which is becoming more and more interdisciplinary, that we stay authentic. We basically should keep doing what we do well A theoretical linguist, an armchair linguist, may I say so, knows how to construct meaningful comparisons. And it's important to construct those meaningful comparisons even once we decide to make a survey rather than write the paper for a lot. So we don't want to throw out crucial comparisons. We don't want to throw out too many comparisons into one analysis. So when we step out of our comfort zone, be that theoretical linguistics or experimental linguistics, we should be as sophisticated as we usually are. And so I would say that good armchair thought experiments are linguistically sophisticated, which means that a lab experiment should be also sophisticated. A study is a study is a study, and a good argument doesn't have to change if it moves from an armchair to a lab. And the result, which is not terribly interesting, doesn't get even much better if your P is very, very low. So that's also an important thing. And the other suggestion I would like to make is that we should all know our studies. And there is an interesting distinction we can borrow from the statistical literature, where the distinction is made between exploratory studies and confirmatory studies. So exploratory studies are needed to establish a general idea, some kind of an empirical landscape. And then we build on that and try to create a solid theory. Confirmatory studies help us choose one analysis over another, help us choose one hypothesis over another. So the question I'd like to ask is whether or not these two types of studies are better fit for the lab or for the armchair. And I think that exploratory studies work really well in an armchair because we need to establish this general idea or an empirical landscape. The second type of studies, confirmatory studies, work very well for the armchair as well, but they also work extremely well as an experimental setup because they can be used as just another argument needed to choose one analysis over another. So if you have several primary data arguments and a couple of experimental arguments, there shouldn't be any difference between those. That's what those confirmatory studies are about. Another thing I learned as I was trying to go between the two sides of the track was that we shouldn't do it all alone. And here's my recipe for success. And as always on the Epicurious, there is room for reviews and additions. So the ingredients are usually include one theoretical linguist, one expert in your target language if you're targeting something unusual, one person who knows how to run experiments and do analysis, many subjects, and people who can run your experiments. And this essentially underlines the importance of teamwork and collaboration. Many smart people running your ideas, methods, and questions. The preparation time is not about the running of the experiment. The preparation time goes into assembling those ingredients, and many months of project discussions, warming, and pilots. And then the cook time when you run your experiment is actually the shortest time. But I think we often think that the cook time will be long, and we sort of ignore the preparation time. So the question is, okay, you're gonna cook all that, where do I get my ingredients? And the answer is rarely in a single place. So that's why we need teams. And of course, that calls for national and international collaboration. Those of us who are a little older learn a lot by being on the team on the dissertation committee, where again, you've got one theoretical linguist, one experimental person, many other people. And one thing that I think is often ignored, and I would like to make a pitch for that, is some kind of community outreach. We need to engage native speaker linguists in our work. And we've all started doing that, so there is a little bit of that already, and hopefully we can do more. So for example, there is wonderful native speaker linguist training in Mesoamerica by people like Judith Aysen, Jessica Kuhn, or Pedro Mateo Pedro. There is a wonderful Jakarta research station where they look at the acquisition of Indonesian. Stavros Kopitis in Germany has been doing native speaker linguist training in Georgia. Hopefully the list will grow longer, and if someone would be giving similar talks many years from now, it won't be just one slide, it will be more slides. Will it always work? No, but we are in the business school, but not in the penny stock market, where the return on investment is 100%, so we don't want to expect 100% return on investment, so we should try. So if we want to do meaningful experiments, it's important to know your own strengths to be able to tell a good argument from a weak one and a good experiment from an uninteresting one. It's important to know the scholarship, which of course is something we teach our students when we teach theoretical courses, but the same applies to experimental work. And it's important to know your study if you go back to the four examples of thought experiments that I gave in the beginning, you want to ask what it is that you want to explore and what you want to confirm. And it's very important to embrace the diversity of perspectives and skills. So I want to bring it back to the idea that it's not a competition, because everyone is an armchair linguist. So we're all trying to balance different ideas, different analysis, different options. So we all need to sit down and think. Thank you.
So for questions, there are two traveling mics, so just raise your hand and ask.
Thanks, I really enjoyed that. I just wanted to ask you, I agree that all of us can probably benefit from spending some time in chairs and thinking, but it seems like one of the things that seems to be a point of conflict between the community of armchair linguists versus community of experimentalists is more about less about what you do in your chair and more about what you consider the standard of evidence to be. So do you feel like that's something that also needs to be addressed?
Oh, absolutely, that's a very good point. And the standard of evidence actually could benefit from what experimental people have been doing, because theoretical linguists are used to thinking about their own thought, like I have this contrast, I'm happy. Or you ask three speakers and you're happy. And in some cases, there are three speakers left, so you can't ask any more. Like, look at Salish. So the question then becomes, do we want to lose the data on Halkomelem because there are only three speakers left, and just say we can't do a massive study? So I think you're absolutely right. We need to observe certain standards of evidence, but we also need to relativize them to particular situations in which we work. And so for those of us who work on small and often exotic languages, the standard of evidence may be lowered, which means that someone will come later if this language is still alive and may change the evidence. But the same could happen for English or Spanish or German.
So I guess I'm wondering to what extent some of these experiments that I think you were sort of describing as confirmatory really are confirmatory rather than exploratory.
Mm-hmm.
So what type of experiment you could imagine running is one where you have a very strong theory and you make a very concrete prediction. You say, I'm going to run the experiment, that prediction's going to come out. And if it doesn't, something's gone very wrong.
Mm-hmm.
I need to revise my theory significantly. But most of the experiments that you were describing, what you really have is two or three different hypotheses, and your experimental results will always sort of end up confirming one of those, right? You predict subject preference or object preference or neither preference, and then no matter what happens, right, you get a confirmation of something. And it seems to me that that's a very different kind of experimental setup, and in some ways it feels much closer to the exploratory stage to me, because you don't really have a strong theoretical framework that's leading you to say, this is really the result I expect to see.
Well, I think that brings two questions. The philosophical question, can you prove or disprove a theory? And that goes back to Laura's question, what are the standards of evidence? If I really like my theory, I may find a way to save it no matter what. And I think this is something that wouldn't change because we start talking to each other. It might be something about the ethos of the field. When I was preparing this talk, I posted a question on Facebook, of all places, asking people whether they can name an experimental study that changed their thinking about a particular theory. I got four answers. I'm going to show you the answers. I'm very glad. Can you guys see? So this was the problem. And this is what I got. Literally, that's it. So we've got superiority effects for German, which I think a lot of people now agree may not be syntactic. Then we've got an answer about subjacency as a processing violation, which some people agree with and some people don't. So we haven't really made a lot of progress here, despite the fact that Aaron Brown will name that. Then we've got Stan's answer. And we've got some work on Martin Huckel's proportional quantifiers. And then there was an answer about Harris and Potts about pragmatic versus semantic calculation. So it's kind of scary how few answers I got. And I don't know what to do about that. And that's why, you know, I wanted to give this talk, because I think that even if we come up with some kind of an experimental solution, the theoretical people may sometimes say, well, it doesn't really convince me. But it could well be partly because the theoretical people are obstinate, but partly because theoretical people may not be convinced by the level of sophistication in the experiment. And theoretical people are very used to balancing very complex primary data. And once our experiments become a little more complicated, more complex, then I think the divide between exploratory and confirmatory will become crisper. For now, we constantly cross this divide, and it depends on essentially who you ask. But I think even if I said everything in the talk I gave is wrong, this slide speaks for itself. I think that's a very, very important fact. We really need to talk to each other.
Hey, I'm sorry, I have to go back a bunch of slides, but one of the examples, you said it was poor syntax. Batman and a joke about him, I thought was okay, and I wanted you to explain it. And sorry, I don't know which one specifically, it was way far back. It would have been bottom right when you get to the slide. Sorry again.
That's what we
need. This one? Is it this one?
Yeah, I told him a joke yesterday that Batman was E.T. That seems okay to me.
Okay.
Anybody else? I don't know. Force a show of hands or whatever. It's probably inappropriate to start with.
Well, that's a wonderful illustration of what Laura was asking about. What are standards of evidence? Okay. How many people like this sentence?
Not with corners. No.
Okay. How many people don't like this sentence?
With which interpretation?
Again, it depends on the intonation. But
yeah. So what I think what's important is that when you look at these sentences, as we look at them on paper, then they probably don't pan out. But they are not good. But as soon as you change prosody, which you did, they become more acceptable. And so something is going on there. And I think we're just in the initial stages of trying to understand what happens. But the fact that several people raised their hands when I asked if it's good, that means that they are doing this prosody in their heads. And when we're constructing our confirmatory or exploratory analysis, we need to pay attention to what these people are constructing prosodically.
This is about the Facebook post, and one thing is that I must have not been on Facebook that day, so that's why I didn't respond.
I'm not surprised.
But I think that, so in this and another remark that you made, I think it was your warning number 4, something that troubles me a little bit about that is the assumption that there's a pre-given set of questions that you're trying to address. Okay, so I think your warning number 4 was something like, well, don't bother unless it's going to address, it's bear on some question in linguistic theory. And there's something like that you were looking for here. And there's a presumption behind that is there's a pre-given set of questions, which is the kinds of questions that have been addressed by armchair linguistics. And if you're not answering those questions, then it's not worth proceeding. And that was the standard that I think people were assuming in this question. Now, there are some things you can be doing which are going to address the kinds of questions that people were already asking. There are many other things you can be doing that would be addressing questions which have all kinds of interest for linguistically, which people weren't asking. Mm-hmm. And so you can do all kinds of things that will bear on that. So I think the notion that we have a pre-given set of questions is something that should be handled with some care. Or that the experiments are valuable to linguistics only if they contribute to that.
No, but what I want to say is that experiments are valuable to linguistics if they can allow us to separate certain explanations. But I also wanted, I remember the slide where I talked about exploratory and confirmatory ideas, and I said that exploratory and confirmatory research is equally good for armchairs. Whereas at the current stage, and the current stage is an important keyword, the current stage of our knowledge, experimental work is better off confirmatory, but like I said in the answer to his question, we often cross the cracks because we start doing something in hopes of confirming a theory, and we do discover new things. Now, my fourth answer was actually about nouns and verbs, where I just was hoping that someone can explain what those polysynthetic languages are doing, as opposed to, you know, looking at another language where we know nouns and verbs are different. So I think there are more nuances to that. And I don't think there is an assumption here, but we need to start somewhere. And the starting point has to be some linguistic theory, because that's what makes us different from psychologists, because we know more about language than psychologists do. And if we don't talk to them and don't tell them what's interesting, we won't have a starting point.
I think we know different things about language.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask about the experiment with the null result, carefully defined experiment with the null result. So it seems to me that, you know, I was surprised that you had the post hoc analysis where you were saying, well, we can still learn something about the theories or whatever given that result. It seems to me that when you have a result like that, it could just simply mean that the experiment, I think in turn is like a probe, just isn't sensitive enough to reveal a distinction that may actually be there. And so I wanted just to see what you say about that.
Yeah, well, this was essentially putting the best face on the failed result. So I could have just said that this is a null result. We didn't confirm what we did. And we now have a hypothetical explanation. I don't want to say that the post hoc analysis is correct. I'm just saying that this might be the next step in trying to figure out if indeed these two pressures cancel each other.
Okay, and of course, so it's also, of course, the case that there could be some other kind of thermal design that could reveal it.
Oh yeah, absolutely, yeah. And that brings us to this other issue, which is what to do with languages for which we don't have comfortable testing settings. we don't have the same richness of measures that we can use for English or Spanish or German, and that makes it a little more difficult. So I'm completely in agreement with you that there are certain limitations here, and like I said, I'm trying to put the best face on the failed effort. Ellen, I think?
I was curious about your comment about native speaker linguists engaging those, and I wonder. I agree. I think with the philosophical stand, I think in practice, the list is actually a lot longer than what you have because there are plenty of Russian speakers, Chinese speakers. There are actually linguists doing experiments as well, and so. I think you are emphasizing on perhaps the languages that have fewer native speaker linguists, but there are actually tons of work done on by native speaker linguists experimentally.
Yeah, I was primarily that's a very good question. I was primarily thinking about smaller languages for which we have very little data, both on the theoretical and experimental side. And the only way we're going to make progress in those is by engaging people who are already there and who speak those languages. And the way to do that is to train them and to make them more into linguists. And I think that's where linguistics may become more global. Yeah.
I know I probably don't have to say this, but it strikes me that there's too much of a dichotomy in what you presented between theoretical linguists and experimental linguists, because every grammaticality judgment is an experiment in the classical, normal sense of the term. That is, we're not any more theoretical than anybody else.
Yeah.
Just an experiment with maybe a huge effect size or one that we can replicate easily or something like that. So So let's say we have a grammaticality judgment effect that we know was there.
Mm-hmm.
There's still things we can learn by taking it to a bigger population.
Oh, yeah.
About how it occurs or where it comes from or something like that. Right? So I just wondered if you would care to comment on that aspect of
That experimental linguistics essentially starts as grammaticality judgments, and then we go back to the question Laura asked, what are our standards? Do we ask ourselves or do we ask more people? And certainly grammaticality judgments are a mini experiment. And then we have to take it further. Once we uncovered more questions, that goes back to Colin's point, we may ask further questions. So I think it just never stops.
Since you brought up ERPs, I just wanted to maybe sketch a contrast that maybe this accords with the dichotomy you set up, but maybe not, but it seems like the history of theorizing about ERPs was in many ways exploratory. So they didn't know, for instance, what affected the N100 or the N400. So let's try different types of stimuli and see what affects these measures of processing, however construed. And oftentimes this was done before functional or theoretical significance had been ascribed to these components, simply as a way of seeing like what happens when we fiddle with this or that. And I think that's led to a productive line of thinking about what these components actually reflect now that we have various ways of adjusting the amplitude here. And so then the counterpoint to your presentation would be, isn't there some utility in just sort of futzing around to see, you know, what affects grammaticality judgments or what affects reading times, that sort of thing?
Yeah, I think that every time we have a new gadget, and the ERP was a new gadget about 35 years ago, we start playing with that and we try to see what it can tell us. And I think that's very important. So I'm not denying the importance of exploratory study, but let's say if you have to make a very limited choice, then I think that using experimental methodology for confirmatory studies will be more beneficial, probably, the first step you want to do. But if tomorrow people come up with another brain scanning study, I'll be the first person to try it. I think there is some kind of inherent attraction in using new tools and new toys, and we all have that. You know, you want the latest iPhone, you want the latest brain imaging.
So that's all the best. Right,
I'm important. Thank you.